Morning, church. Good to see everybody today. Hey, Merry Christmas, right? Hey, guess what's happening Christmas Eve? Church, yeah, we're going to have a Christmas Eve service, right? And I want you, let's pack this place out. Let's invite all our family and friends, right? We're going to have a great time. And I tell you what, we've been talking about that all month. We've been talking about how, well, actually, guess what? Santa Claus is going to be here 5 to 6, free pictures. So any of you big kids, little kids, whatever you want to do, come here and check out Santa. Service is at 6 o'clock. Invite your friends. And we've been talking all month about how we've wanted to do random acts of generosity. We started that at the beginning of the month, how we can just go out and just bless people and invite people to church to hear Jesus. In fact, we're going to give you some illustrations on this video. Just check this thing out. Isn't that fun? That is so awesome. We have plenty of time to do that. Just dream up ways that you could potentially bless somebody. But hey, we started this series last week, Unwrapped, our Christmas series. I appreciate Greg Coolidge here challenging the church just to be all that God made us to be. And this is our second in this series. And I just started thinking about how blessed I am to be the pastor of this church. You know what I mean? Because we've got such a variety of people in this place. You know what I'm saying? We have such an eclectic group. I mean, look around at all the different people. Go ahead, look around. Don't point, but just look at all the different people that we have here. I mean, would you agree? Isn't it pretty awesome that we experience church like this? I mean, we have people of different ages in here, different races in here, different economic background, different preferences. I mean, we have people that think, I mean, let me prove it to you. How many of you guys like to listen. You just love country music. Just raise your hand if you like country music. Look around. Look at that. Yeah. Okay. How many of you like hip hop? Hip hop. Raise your hand. Yeah. How many of you hip hop and country? That'd be a weird album, right? I know what I'm saying. Jazz. Got any jazz fans? Yeah. Rock and roll. Yeah, different people, right? And we probably have different preferences in television shows and movies. How many of you all went and saw Star Wars over the past few days? Just raise your hand. Oh my word, repent. Oh man, you know what I'm saying? I'm telling you, no, I'm not saying anything. But there are things that are different, that bring us together, actually. And there are some things that are very similar that we all kind of gravitate to that we have in common. And I think I'll put my finger on one of those things. And whether you're Christian or non-Christian, and if you're a non-Christian here today, you're going, Pastor, you could have nothing in common with me. But I think that I've landed on this one thing that we could think. I mean, I'd give my last Bible to just bet that nobody likes to feel stuck, right? Nobody wants to wake up in the morning and go, all right, God, I want to get stuck in traffic. I just want to get stuck in a meeting. I want to get stuck after school. I mean, nobody likes to get stuck. I mean, nobody prays that, right? If you're normal, you don't want to get stuck. I was at a red light one time, and I was in like the left lanes that were turning, had the arrows and the green straight lights. The light turned green on this lady, and I was still at the red, and the lady in the left lane did not see the light turn green. She was probably tweeting somebody about how she hated sitting at a red light, right? And the people behind her got patient, and they beeped their horns, and when she realized what was going on, she took off. But like through the yellow light, and everybody behind her got stuck at the red light, and they were mad about that. I can tell you that. You know, people were angry. Ever been to the grocery store? Got stuck? Last night, Walmart. I kid you not, got behind a guy, forgot his credit card. He had to pull out his cash, and he had to go through what he didn't want. He didn't want his bananas. He didn't want this can. And we had to stand there, and we kind of struck up a conversation. Merry Christmas, brother. He was repenting. I'm glad he was repenting. But nobody wants to feel stuck. And I'd be willing to bet today that there are people in here because of some circumstance in your life. If you were to describe and sum up your life in one word, it would be that word right there, stuck, right? And maybe you feel like you're stuck in a marriage because it's like, you know what, I don't know if I can endure this thing. Maybe you feel like you're stuck financially. It's Christmas, and it's like, you know what, I've never been in this position before. Maybe spiritually you feel stuck. We've had all year to step it up and give 10 minutes of day reading the Bible and praying to God, and we've not been able to fulfill that, and we've just been stuck in these circumstances, and it's like, why do I feel this way? Listen, every one of us has been in this position where we feel stuck. And if we're real honest, we live in a world that feels like it's pretty stuck, right? I mean, I can predict for you the next 24, 48-hour news cycle. You're going to turn on the television news, and you're going to see where some terrorist threat is about to occur. Some country is arguing with the governments, arguing with one another. I mean, that's just, you just change the names. It's the same thing that happens. I'm telling you, our world needs a dose of hope. I think this Christmas season, maybe, unlike any other season. And I know there are people here. You'd pay top dollar for a little bit of hope in your life because you feel stuck. And you work with people that you know feel stuck. You have relatives that feel stuck. And I'm telling you, you can bring hope into your life and into the life of others around you if you would just be willing to focus on this one word. And this word is yes. If we say yes to God, yes to God. God, I know I'm in this circumstance, but I tell you what, whatever it takes, yes, I'm going to listen to you and get through this. God, you know what? I don't know when, where, or how, and you might be wanting me to invite somebody or reach out to somebody that I know who doesn't go to church, who doesn't even believe in you, and I'm just today, right now, yes. I'm just going to say yes. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to say yes to you. My answer is yes. That's why we've challenged everybody in the church just to participate in these radical acts of kindness, just to be able to bless and give the world hope, to put a smile on their face. Because I'm telling you, one yes can change the world. And we're going to look at the yes that changed the world in this story. And we're going to look at it in Luke chapter 1 today. And if you're from a church background, you're familiar with this story. If you're from an unchurched background, you're familiar with the story in Luke chapter 1 because it's the announcement of the birth of Jesus Christ. So let me give you just a little bit of some background about this. The nation of Israel at this time when Jesus was born was stuck. It was stuck politically because Israel was occupied by the Roman authorities. They were stuck spiritually because they hadn't heard from God in 400 years. It's the silent years, the period of time between the Old Testament and the New Testament where God had not spoken to anybody. There were no prophecies. There were no supernatural. Give me some more coffee this morning. Supernatural acts of God. It is caffeinated, by the way. But it was a silent year. God had not, and the nation felt absolutely stuck. That's the macro version. Let's look at the micro version. There was a woman, and she gave birth to baby Jesus. And on the count of three, I want you to say this woman's name. One, two, three. Isn't that something? If you're filling out your bulletin, this is the first point in it. When God seems uninvolved, circumstances can make you feel stuck. circumstances can make you feel. Mary was stuck. She was stuck in a town called Nazareth. Nothing good came out of Nazareth, the Bible says. That was kind of the sentiment of the nation at that time. And Bible commentators speculate there were about 400 people living in Nazareth at the time of Jesus' birth, but it was a hick town. And some of us grew up in hick towns, right? And what'd you say? When I grow up, I'm going to get out of this hick town because that's what you're going to do. But she was stuck. She was not only stuck in this town, she was stuck in an arranged marriage. Stuck in an arranged marriage. How many teenagers do we have? Raise your hand. How many teenagers do we have in here this morning, right? How would you like it? Hey, raise them hands. Raise those hands. How would you like it if your mom and dad arranged your marriage? Huh? Yeah. No, nobody, right? I have an 8-year-old daughter, and I'm kind of into arranged marriages. Like when she's 27, I might just do that. I might just make that happen. But arranged marriages were common back in Jesus' day, and like it wasn't like Mary went to Starbucks, right? And was standing in line, and kind of saw Joseph, and they kind of met over a latte, started up this discussion, kind of fell in love with one another. You know what I'm saying? That didn't happen. It was like Mary came home one day, and her parents said, "Hey, Mary, we got this guy that we're gonna have you marry. Okay, what's his name? Joe? You kidding me? Joe? Just Joe, right? Joe. I mean, you set up with a guy. Next thing you're gonna tell me he's a carpenter, like Joe the carpenter. You know what I'm saying? Mary felt stuck. See, we always see the Christmas story as something beautiful." Something that was awesome and nice, but I'm telling you what, it was messy. Mary was stuck in an arranged marriage in a hick town. You think she felt stuck? Absolutely, she felt stuck. So let's kind of step into her story in Luke chapter 1, beginning with verse 26, when the Bible tells us this, in the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, it's the other story just before this one, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee. God sent this angel. So here's Mary thinking she's stuck. It's like God absolutely has abandoned me. God has nothing to do with me. But isn't it funny how God knew exactly where Mary was in her circumstances? And in his time, he sent an angel to communicate to her. And there are people today, I know, that you might feel stuck. But what we call stuck, God calls set up for a miracle. That he's getting us ready for a miracle. And there's some people here that might be stuck in circumstances or situations, and you're like, well, God has completely forgotten me. But this verse right here, if you don't get anything else out of this message today, this verse right here tells us that God knows exactly where you are in your circumstances, and in his time, he's going to set you up for a supernatural act in your life. Now this next verse that we're going to look at, if you're from a church background, you might get offended at this verse, but I want to point something out that the Bible points out, and I want you to understand I'm not trying to be offensive in this, but I want to just try to explain it because I think it's an important point of the whole Bible narrative. Verse 27, it says that God sent an angel Gabriel to Nazareth in a town in Galilee to a virgin pledged or stuck to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. Now, I want to look at this word virgin and what it means. This word, if you use this word today in any conversation, you just walk up and you drop that word, everybody's going to stop because they're going to like, why are you like using that word? They're just going to look at you. But the word virgin is so significant to Jesus and to the Christmas story. And in fact, I just want to say it. Can we just say that out loud, just on the count of three, just say the word virgin. 1, 2, 3. Virgin. See, I didn't find out to what virgin meant until I was like in the seventh grade, and it was used derogatorily at that time because people would go, they'd get mad at somebody and go, "You virgin." And they'd say, "I ain't no virgin," and nobody knew what it meant. But it was, we acted like it was the worst thing ever. We had a library, and I went to middle school, seventh and eighth grade school, and I went to the library and I looked that up. It wasn't until the seventh grade till I found out what that was. And the reason that I'm talking about this is because the Bible emphasizes it so much in these verses that we're reading, because A virgin is somebody who has never had relations with a man. And if that's the first time that you've ever heard that, you might want to talk to your parent and kind of discuss that a little bit. But why was Luke emphasizing this word? Why couldn't he said the woman or the girl or the person? But he said this. He said, he wants us to know that Mary was a virgin. I mean, church can be educational if we just listen fast. Verse 28 says, the angel went to her and said, greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you. Do you think Mary felt favored? Do you think Mary felt like the Lord was with her? That the Lord was like blessing her? No, I'm sure when the angel showed up and said, greetings, Mary, the Lord is with you. She's like, you kidding me? I'm in Nazareth. I'm stuck with a guy named Joseph. You kidding me? But this is what I love about the Christmas story. This Christmas story is proof that she felt like she was stuck, but God was setting her up for a miracle to happen in her life. And out of the darkness, God just appeared to her and said, Mary, I know you feel stuck, but I want to give you hope today because I want you to know that you're favored and I am with you. Which leads to point number two, which is when God is involved, the impossible can happen. When God's involved, the impossible can happen. The Bible says Mary was highly favored, that the Lord was with her. And the reason that's so important is there are people that feel just like Mary in her life. Feel like you're stuck in your circumstances or your situation. And it's like, I wish I could get visited by an angel. Hey, I know it's Christmas. It's all about hope and joy, but why can't God speak to me? Listen, Jesus Christ is proof. The Christmas season that rolls around every year is proof that every one of us here in this room are favored and the Lord wants to be with each one of us. The Lord wants to be with us because he's custom designed us. He's made us on purpose, with a purpose, and for a purpose. You might have been an accident to your parents, but God made you on purpose. I'm telling you, for a reason. He's got plans that you could never have for yourself because he loves us so much. And this is as true about Mary as it is true about you, whether you feel like it or not. Faith is taking that one step further when you don't feel like God's involved in your life at all. And the text goes on, starting with verse 29, that Mary was greatly troubled at his words, as you would have been. You know, you open up the door and there's an angel standing there. That'd freak you out. And wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, do not be afraid. Mary, you found favor with God. There it is again. You'll be with child and give birth to a son, and you'll give him the name Jesus. He will be great. Was the angel true? Was the angel's words accurate? He will be great. Listen, there are millions of people all over the world today that are worshiping and singing songs to Jesus Christ because he will be great. And he will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end. His kingdom will never end. I mean, this is the most incredible news ever. But Mary had a question. Very logical question. This angel's laying all this stuff on me. And look what Mary asks. How will this be, Mary asked the angel, since I am a virgin? See, I'm not bringing it up. Luke is repeatedly bringing this up three times. Because listen, a pregnant virgin is not just difficult. A pregnant virgin is impossible. But with God, with his involvement, all things are possible. And there's some people here today that you might feel like you're in impossible circumstances. And I'm telling you that God might just be setting you up for a miracle to be involved in your life. I mean, if God can bring somebody back from the dead and make virgins pregnant, I mean, what can he do with your circumstances if you would just say yes to God today during this Christmas season? Listen, I want to be the pastor of a church that doesn't try difficult things. I want to be the pastor of a church that tries impossible things, right? Because doing the impossible allows for what? Allows God to be involved with the miraculous. And Mary had this question because she knew what the angel was talking about was absolutely impossible. No woman has ever gone into a room that was unpregnant and for 8 hours went, and walked out of that room pregnant. It does not happen. It does not happen. It will not happen. I have been a pastor for over 2 decades, and I have people go, I don't know how in the world we got pregnant. And I tell them, because we know, I don't even have to look that up, do you? I mean, we know how that happens. But Mary was so puzzled by this. Look at what happens in verse 35. Verse 35 goes on. The angel answered, you know, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. In other words, Mary, I'm going to get involved with your life. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her own age. And she who was said to be barren is in her 6th month. For this is key right here. For nothing is impossible with God. And you can take that to the bank. And God was essentially asking Mary, look, Mary, I've got an assignment for you. It's very important. I am with you. I'm going to make this thing happen. Are you going to say yes? Are you going to say yes, Mary? And that's what God is asking of us today. Are you going to say yes? Am I going to say yes? Which is point 3 if you're filling out your outline. Will you say yes to Jesus this Christmas season, just like Mary did? So if you're taking notes, there's 2 words I want to highlight. I want to highlight, if you want to write these down. And that's risk and responsibility. Risk and responsibility. Risk and responsibility. Do you think God was asking Mary to take a risk here? You better believe it. You better believe it. Number one, she had to risk her reputation. You know what I'm saying? I mean, do you really think people bought this whole story? Hey, you know what? The angel visited me and I got pregnant and I've never had relations with a man. I mean, you really think when Mary said that people believed her? Like me and Joseph? And they're like, yeah, sure. And when the baby comes out, he's going to ride a unicorn. We get it, Mary. You know, it's cool. We got that. You know what? Now listen, when Mary took on this risk to give birth to the Savior, she was risking her responsibility, because Jesus growing up, let me tell you, everybody in that small community knew Jesus was an illegitimate child. They knew who Jesus was. See, we try to make it just happy and nice, but the Christmas story was a mess. It was ugly. And she was going to have to take a risk if she was going to say yes to God. But listen, I want to be the pastor of a church that takes risks for God. And when I say risks, I'm talking about doing whatever it takes to get people to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's why from the beginning of the month, we said, look, we gave away the chicken things, like to go out and just invite people to church and give them a free chicken sandwich. Had a guy call me last week and he said, hey, do you have any more of those cards? He said, I want to go buy some chicken sandwiches and give them out and invite people to church. And I'm like, you better believe it. I'll give you all the cards that you need. But that's why our Christmas Eve service, we're like inviting Santa Claus to come and have free pictures, because we just want to do whatever it takes to take a risk to get people here to see Jesus. And it can be risky making an invitation, can't it? It can be risky for your reputation if you ask somebody. But there are all kinds of people that need to hear about Jesus. And you might have to risk your reputation to do that. Because listen, Mary wasn't worried about her reputation. She was worried about being obedient to God. And I know some people are like, you know what? I've been inviting that person for years. For years. I don't know if I can do it again. Are you saying that maybe a miracle would need to take place before that person would come to know Jesus? Maybe God has prepared that person and you for years to be able to make that extra invitation this year. Just to be able to extend that. Don't give up on those people. Because God did not give up on you. But life's risky. Is not life risky? Is it risky or not? Life is risky. I mean, how many people have ever flown in an airplane? You know what I'm saying? How many people have done it? It's risky. I mean, you probably don't even know the guy that flew the last airplane that you flew, right? You know what? Pastor Philip was gone a couple of weeks ago. And we had a guest band. People asked where he was, and I failed to tell everybody. He was doing a wedding down in Arizona, and guess what? He had to fly to get there. I didn't know this, but Pastor Philip doesn't like to fly. He said on the way back, there was this turbulence, and the plane, like, took this big dip, and he said, everybody screamed, and the spirit of atheism left the plane. Philip said he passed out. No, that's not true. But I learned that he hates to fly. Is that going to stop Pastor Philip from flying? No, it's not. But taking a flight is risky. I mean, different things, there are risks with different things that we do. I mean, falling in love is risky. Anybody here today in love? Raise your hand. You better raise your hand. Anybody in love here today? Right? That's right. Falling in love's risky. It's risky. I remember one time falling in love years ago. And I was going to ask this girl out. And word got around somehow. I was going to ask her out. And word got back to me. She's never going to go out with me. 20 years later, I found out what she was doing. And I'm so glad God didn't let that happen. You know what I'm saying? I mean, that falling in love is risky. Going to work is risky. Getting a new job is risky. And one of the things that I want us to get as a church is we want to be a risky church. It should not be our goal as Christians to arrive at death safely, because if nothing is impossible with God, Christians should be the biggest risk takers there are, right? And do whatever it takes to tell people about the gospel of Jesus Christ, because we have a God who majors in the impossible, right? The second word is responsibility. Responsibility. There's risk and there's responsibility. Ladies, I've never been pregnant. I know it's Christmas, but my wife has been pregnant, right? And for those of you who have been pregnant, when you get farther along into pregnancy, does it get uncomfortable, ladies? Does it not? I mean, like the baby's in there, he's pushing around, he's kicking you, he's pushing down on your bladder. One night when my wife was pregnant, you know, a year ago, it was like, she said, look at this. And like there was a little hand or a foot that like went all the way across her belly, like an alien. You know what I'm saying? I said, cover that thing up. I don't want to, you know, it's uncomfortable, right? Being pregnant. If you know what I'm talking about. There's a lot of responsibility associated with being pregnant. Is there not? When you have a baby like growing inside of you, ladies, there is responsibility in that. And God was telling Mary, look, I want to put something inside of you that nobody else can take credit for. I'm going to do this thing, and it's going to grow, and you're going to give birth to a miracle if you'll just say yes. Mary, if you'll just say yes. And what God wants to do in you is to put something inside of you, his spirit, that will grow, and that nobody else can take credit for that except him. And all he needs for you to do is for you to say yes. And I believe that God can bring forth a miracle in your life. But we got to be willing to say yes to this responsibility. And a thing that I am praying for every one of us here during this Christmas season, that God would put the desire in our hearts to be able just to have the boldness and the responsibility to extend an invitation to somebody that needs hope. And look, if you're not the person that needs hope today, you know family members that need hope. Do you not? I mean, some of you have given birth to children who need that hope. Some of you, it's your parents. But we need to have that responsibility for God to put that in us. And I'll put it this way. You know, if we're followers of Christ, Christ's last command should be our first responsibility. His last command to go into all the world and to preach the gospel should be our first responsibility. And we have a chance to do that as we step into Christmas, as we go out the remainder of these days before Christmas, to see people in this. When people are willing to talk, even if they're stuck in line at the grocery store, and I'm telling you, invite them to church. Invite them to church. A lot of people start coming to church after the first of the year. And I tell you what, we got an amazing lineup starting in January. I can't wait to tell you about that stuff. But it starts today, with God putting that desire inside of us, that responsibility to go out and do what he would have Mary to do, that he'll have us to do, to tell somebody the news of what this season is about. So here's the deal. The angel shows up to Mary and says, Mary, look, you're not stuck. I want you to take some risk. I want you to receive some responsibility. And look, this is what I want to do. I'm going to work a miracle in your life. Are you in? I love Mary's response. Verse 38. Look at what she says. I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. May it be to me as you have said. Then the angel left her. I am the Lord's servant. What's verse 38 mean in a nutshell? Mary said yes to the risk and responsibility that God was going to work into her life. And because Mary said yes, guess what? Jesus was born. And every one of us has been impacted by a teenager who said yes, and she lived in the middle of nowhere. She was stuck in this place, but God is actually setting her up for a miracle. And if God could do that to a girl 2,000 years ago, he can still do that today in this culture that we live in. And I'm just curious, what could happen if we all said yes? If we all said yes. Because listen, you know somebody who's stuck. And they're stuck in their circumstances. They're stuck in their situation. And eternity is too long to get it wrong. So are you willing? Are you willing to say yes today? I was thinking about this a couple of weeks ago. I was driving around up in the mountains. And I had the whole family in the pickup truck. And we started the thing a few years ago where we go out and we cut down our own Christmas tree. If you've ever seen Christmas Vacation, my kids love it just like Clark Griswold's kids loved it in that Christmas Vacation. And if you've ever seen that movie, watch it on television and not on DVD where it's not cut. Thanks, Jim Tanner. Anyway, that's another story. But we were up in the mountains driving around. And they give us this map. You can go get a $10 tag, cut down your tree, and they give you a map. And I'm the kind of guy that I want to exhaust every spot on this map where you can cut down a tree because I want to find that tree where the light's shining on it, right? And that requires a lot of driving. It requires a lot of hiking. And, you know, the kids have a blast for about 10 minutes and then it's over. But after a couple of hours of driving, and it's tight up there on some of those mountain roads, there's snow. And I was pulling around. We had agreed upon one tree. We're going to go back and look at this tree. We'd mark the place where it was at. I drove back, but there was not a place to drive off. So I was going to pull off the road. And I thought the road went over further. But when I went to the left to park, all that snow, it was a ditch. And I slid down into that ditch and stopped. And the kids are like, Daddy, are we stuck? Are we stuck? And it's like, we wouldn't move. I pressed on the gas and it just spun. But I'm a man, and men are never stuck, and men are never lost. Amen, men? Now, for all the rednecks in the room, I'm going to connect. My heart is going to connect with yours right now like it's never done. So the kids are like, are we stuck? Are we stuck? Dad kicks the F-150 up into neutral, and he flips the switch to four-wheel drive low. Right? And I put it in gear and I pressed on the gas. You know what happened? I climbed out of that ditch and the kids are going, cool, Daddy. I said, yes, that is cool, kids. And I parked that and we went and got our tree. It was awesome. It was awesome. But I was thinking about that. There are people in this world that are stuck and they are spent and they don't have four-wheel drive low. And they're spinning in life, and they're getting deeper and deeper and deeper stuck, the deeper they get. But if you and I say yes, I'm telling you, we can give the hope of the world to the people and tell them the traction that they can get in Jesus if they were to say yes to him and have their lives completely transformed. And I believe that if we'll step up and say yes and invite Jesus to this place, he can change lives because that's what Jesus does. I really believe that. So I want to extend to you this invitation today that there are people that you know who don't go to church. And I want you to think about that person's name. I want God to put that on your heart and on your mind. And I want you to go and then to plan a strategy and invite that person to church. I mean, invite them to Christmas Eve. I mean, wouldn't it be great if we had standing room only at Christmas Eve service, you know, coming up this week? It'd be awesome. Because we want to be a church that takes risks, but we also want to be a church that's being responsible. And that takes each person being the church, going out and being the church to be responsible. So think of that person's name. Think of that person's name. Allow God just to impress that upon your heart. And then go out and tell them the good news about Jesus. If you say yes. And I know there are people here today too that you might need to say yes to God today in your own life, because maybe you've never even said yes to Jesus before ever and received him into your life as your personal Savior. Maybe you keep saying no in these compartmentalized areas of your life, and you need to let that go to God and say, God, whatever it is, yes. I mean, I'm just tired of messing around. I've been trying to do it my way for so long, and it's just not been working. Maybe today you need to say yes, whatever it is that you need to say yes to. I encourage you today, through inspiration of what Mary said yes to so many years ago, of how it changed our lives even today, because of the birth of a Savior. And I think that's what God is able to do every Christmas season, is allow for that door of invitation to open like never before. So don't give up on those people that need to know Jesus, because God never gave up on you. Would you stand with me as we pray? Would you stand with me, every head bow, every eye closed? Father, I pray today for every person in this room to have the courage to know that you are a God of the impossible, that you do major in miracles, and that you have never met a person that you cannot change. You've never met a life that you cannot change. And I pray today, as people here say yes, that we would see miracles happen in this church and people's lives change as only you can change them. Father, I pray that. And for those of you here today, if there is that circumstance or that habit that you need just to be able to have help to get up out of, to be able to say yes to God with. Maybe today you're here and you've never said yes to Jesus. We're going to give you an opportunity to respond, to have the assistance, because listen, we cannot do life alone. We've got to break that pattern of thinking to be able to progress in life and to step out in that step of faith. So I'm just declaring today to everybody here, we've got our care team, our prayer partners who are going to make their way to the lobby right now. And I'm telling you, if you need to get out of a circumstance and you need God's miracle in your life, I'm telling you, the first step to do that is to be able to pray with somebody. And they're out in the lobby waiting for you. Right now, I'm just saying, you can step out of your aisle and you can go back and talk to this person. Or if you want to receive Jesus, go out and talk to this person. We've got prayer cards out there, and we just want you to write your name on that. They're going to instruct you to do that, write a prayer request. And there will be people praying for you every day this week. If you'll just move and say yes to Jesus Christ. To not hold back. To say, God, whatever it is, I'm going to say yes today. Father, I pray that we will not be a church that refuses to take the risk or run from that responsibility. And I pray that you give us each the strength, the hope, the will to say yes to you and to go out and invite somebody to church, to engage in radical acts of generosity, to tell somebody about Jesus. And I pray that for those in this room that need a miracle, that you would be able to well up inside of them and grow inside of them in a way maybe like they've never known before. And although you won't snap and change their circumstances immediately, you will change them eventually, because you are a God who cares for your children and will bring about good things eventually. And I pray, Father, today that we could be a church that could say yes to this world that is so lacking in hope. And we pray that you'd give us the power to say yes, as Mary said yes. And everybody who agreed with that said, amen, amen. And we have Empower today after church?
Open house.
Open house, that's right, open house. He might be afraid of planes, but he knows what's going on around here. Right after we sing, and we're going to have an offering right now. And if you didn't go out to pray, if you have a prayer request, fill out a card and drop that in the offering bag, is when we sing, they're going to be passed right now. May the Lord bless you this week and see you, if I don't see you on the way out the door, Christmas Eve.